Amen. Good morning. Happy Easter. Happy Easter to you. Yeah, I was trying to think how the response goes with that, but it was good anyways. Let's say it together as I'll say, Christ is risen, and I want you to say in response, He is risen indeed. Ready? Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen, amen. Today is a great day of celebration as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I hope that everyone is enjoying their time as we celebrate on this special day. We are excited this morning to also have the baptism of Eden and Jacob Zylstra this morning as well. And so as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we celebrate our Lord. And so let us stand and declare the proclamation of Christ's resurrection given by the angel. So let us stand and say our call to worship together. Don't be alarmed, he said. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, we thank you for the joy that is set before us because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Lord, we know that it is our sins that put Jesus on the cross, but it is for that very purpose of dying for our sins that Jesus came, because Jesus came to die so that we may live. And knowing that Christ was raised from the grave, we are filled with joy and hope, for we serve a living God. God, we thank you for the gift of salvation given to us in Jesus Christ. We thank you for the power of the resurrection. And we thank you for the hope given to us that we will be with Christ forever in heaven through faith in Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, through faith, may today be a day of great celebration for what you have done for us in Jesus Christ. And may every day of our lives be a celebration of your grace. And may we all be filled with your Holy Spirit and knowledge of your holy word, trusting you in all things. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. At this time, in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, let us greet one another.
Jesus, Lord, is risen today. Alleluia. Sons of men and angels say, Alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high. Alleluia. Singing.
Seated. Hear these words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. The Apostle Paul writes to the church at Ephesus, "For there is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all." Brothers and sisters in Christ, baptism is a sign and seal of God's promise to this covenant people. In baptism, God promises by grace alone to forgive our sins, to adopt us into the body of Christ, the church, to send the Holy Spirit daily to renew and cleanse us, and to resurrect us to eternal life. The promise is made visible in the water of baptism. Water cleanses, purifies, refreshes, sustains. Jesus Christ is the living water. And through baptism, Christ calls us to new obedience, to love and trust God completely, to forsake the evil of the world, and to live a new and holy life. Yet when we fall into sin, we must not despair of God's mercy, nor continue in sin, for baptism is a sign and seal of God's eternal covenant of grace with us. And so it is at this time the Board of Elders come to present Eden and Jacob Zylstra for baptism, and I now invite the family to come forward. And Harold Zylstra, who has served as elder, will be presenting their certificate of baptism and also praying for the family. Well, beloved of God, I ask you before God and Christ Church to renew your vows. Do you acknowledge that you are sinners, forgiven only through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ on your behalf?
I do.
Do you believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord?
I do.
Do you promise to instruct these children in the truth of God's word, in the way of salvation through Jesus Christ, to pray for them, teach them to pray, and to train them in Christ's way by your example through worship and nurture of the church?
I do.
And do you promise to accept the spiritual guidance of the church, to walk in a spirit of Christian love with his congregation, and seek those things that make for unity, purity, and peace?
I do.
At this time, I ask everyone to stand. And I ask you, the church, do you promise to love, encourage, and support these children by being an example of Christian faith and character, and by giving the strong support of God's family in fellowship, prayer, and service? If so, say we do. And now as we make our commitments before one another and before God, let us now state our faith together as stated in the Apostles' Creed, which can be found on the screen. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. All right, let us pray. Lord, we give thanks for the gift of water. For in the beginning of creation, your Spirit moved over the waters. In the waters of the flood, you destroyed evil. You led the children of Israel through the sea into the freedom of the promised land. In the river Jordan, John baptized our Lord, and your Spirit anointed him. By his death and resurrection, Jesus Christ, the living water, forgives us, frees us from sin and death, and opens the way to life everlasting. We thank you, O God, for the gift of baptism. In this water, you confirm to us that we are buried with Christ in his death, raised to share in his resurrection, and are being renewed by the power of the Holy Spirit, united to Christ in mission. Lord, we pray now that you send your Holy Spirit upon this water, that this water may be a spring gushing up to eternal life. Wash away sins, raise them to new life, and grant them to the body of Christ. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon these children, that they may have wisdom to discern their gifts, strength to obey your will, and joy in answering your call. To you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, be all praise, honor, and glory, now and forever. Amen. All right, as you can tell, Eden and Jacob are very excited for their baptism today. And so, Eden, can you see the water over here? And see, all right. So Eden and Jacob, for you Jesus came into the world. For you he died and conquered death. All this he did for you too. Though you know nothing of it as yet, we love because God first loved us. And so Eden, Joanna, I'm going to put some water on your head. Can I do that? Okay. I baptize you in the name of the Father. And the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jacob Magnus Switzel, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Eden and Jacob, children of the covenant, in baptism you are sealed by the Holy Spirit, marked as God's own forever, and called to follow Christ in mission. Amen. And at this time, I ask Harold as elder to offer a prayer for you guys, both as elder of this church, and do you know this guy? You see him around once in a while, huh? Yeah. As elder and grandpa.
First of
all. Should be. Yep, you're on.
Okay. First of all, I have the baptism certificates and a couple books for each of the kids that were presented by the church, and I'll just hang on to them until we get down because you got to get your arms full. Should we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning on this very, very special Sunday. And Lord, we are so grateful that Jesus was willing to give up his life so that we can have eternal life. But Lord, we also want to pray for Eden and also for Jake as they are just starting their journey in life, and Lord, we just pray that at some point you'll touch their hearts and they'll want to follow you and be your servants and do the things that you have in store for them, and I'm sure you have great things in store for them as you do for all the children in this church. Lord, we also want to pray for Josh and Kelly as they go through to raise these children to adulthood, and Lord, that give them the words and the wisdom and the materials that they need, and that they present a lifestyle that is desirable to you and is a good witness to these children. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Right. Now it is a little tradition. Eden, do you want to go meet the church family a little bit? You want to walk with me?
You want to go, Pastor Kim?
Want to hold my hand? Go with your brother? Okay. All right. So we'll go for a little walk. Want to take your brother along with us? Let's go this way. All right. Yeah. So this is a, oh, all right. I think Jacob found the Easter eggs already. Yep. I think we got stuck here. Yeah, that's not going to work.
I know, we saw something good.
We did, all right. Well, I'll tell you what, after the service, we'll go meet the church people. Does that sound good? All right. Oh. Well, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, the only King and Head of the Church, I declare this brother, this sister, are now received into the visible membership of the Holy Church, baptized to confess Christ to be God's faithful servants until life's end. And so let's thank God for these. And Josh growing up in this church and Mary and Kelly, a wonderful wife and person, they're living on the East Coast, and so we'll continue to pray for you guys and support you in any way we can as well. And so, like I said earlier, if you want after the service, I'll get a chance and see if you can get to meet Eden and Jacob as well, as they're delightful kids. So praise God for his covenant of grace and the hope of the resurrection we have, isn't it? What a wonderful celebration it is to be part of God's family. At this time, speaking of children and raising our kids and praying for them and supporting our children, we have our children's message this morning. And so I want to invite all the kids to come up, and I guess you got a little sneak peek of what might be coming. But our children's message is another way we can continue to pray and support and encourage our children along with many other things we do. So kids, come on up.
All right, good morning. You guys are looking pretty good this morning. Pretty special day today? All right, Easter, right? So really, Easter's pretty awesome. I mean, how many people love chocolate bunnies and candy eggs and all of that? That's all pretty cool, right? Okay, but we're going to learn a little bit about that today and by why Easter should be like the most awesome day there is, especially for Christians, for everybody. But when you're Christians, it's amazing. So how many of you have colored Easter eggs already? Anybody? A few of you? Pretty fun, huh? So we can learn something from an egg, all right? So we got some eggs here. Now, if you're super hungry, let's say you're super hungry for scrambled eggs, all right? And I said, all right, you're super hungry for scrambled eggs. And I did this. Would you be excited? You're hungry for scrambled eggs. There's something in there. That's pretty cool, right? All right. But let's say, okay, hey, I'm super hungry for scrambled eggs. What if I did this? Would you be hungry? Would you be excited? It's empty. All right. Let's say you want to get some cereal and you go to the refrigerator and the milk carton's empty. Are you like, yes, it's empty. I'm fired up. No? Okay, let's think about it. Can you think of anything that's empty that you get excited for? Like something. We'll get there, all right? Right? But really, in real life, is anything exciting when it's empty? It isn't, is it? We're not excited about that. But today, we do celebrate something that's pretty cool that's empty, and some of you just said it. We celebrate the empty tomb, don't we? And you know what? That empty tomb is so awesome because you know what it means? It means that Jesus is alive. He's not there. But so we're going to talk about three things why that empty tomb is so awesome for everybody here today. But how did it get empty? All right, now remember, Jesus died on the cross, right? And when he was off the cross, they took his body, and Joseph of Arimathea wanted to take his body and put some perfume on it, as was the custom. So he did, and they put it in the tomb. But do you know Jesus promised he would raise from the dead, didn't he? And Pilate, you know what Pilate was afraid of? He was afraid that somebody would sneak into the tomb, steal the body, and then pretend like Jesus raised. So you know what they did? They took that huge stone, put it in front of the tomb, and then they put guards in front of it to make sure that nobody could get in or out. All right? Now, the next morning, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus, came to the tomb because they wanted to put perfume on Jesus and get him ready for burial. Okay? Now, do you see a problem here? If there's a tomb and guards, how are they going to get to Jesus' body? Is that a problem? Kinda. But you know what? Not a problem. Because as they were on their way, there was a huge earthquake. The stone rolled away. An angel sat on it. And the guards, they said the guards shook like dead men. They were so afraid. So when the Marys got there, there was an angel sitting there, and he said, "Do not be afraid. I know you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He's not here." Pretty cool, huh? But I didn't really, when I was doing this, I thought about it. Why was the stone rolled away? Was it rolled away so Jesus could get out? Do you think so? He was already gone, wasn't he? The stone wasn't rolled away so Jesus could get out. The stone was rolled away so Mary could see in. And I think it's rolled away for us today. Jesus didn't need help. He wasn't there. So that empty tomb promises, can you guys try to remember this? It promises three things. One, most importantly, the empty tomb, Jesus is alive. Because if he wasn't alive and the tomb wasn't empty, no one would be here today. Wouldn't matter, would it? We would have no faith. There wouldn't be anything. So Jesus is alive. Awesome. Two, you know what the empty tomb means? Forgiveness. It means that Christ died on the sin and we are forgiven. Now, do any of you ever sin? Do you ever need forgiveness? Have you ever pushed your brother, fought, misbehaved, told a little lie? Sheepish hands go up. Now, here's another question for you. Have you ever done that same thing twice? Three times? Four times? You know what? Jesus said he would forgive us 70 times 7. Like, he will forgive us all the time. But we that doesn't mean we can push our brother down every day because it's like, no big deal, Jesus is going to forgive me, right? We're not supposed to do that. And when we ask for forgiveness, we have to mean it. Now, I've heard this at my house a couple times. Have you ever had to say, someone say, tell them you're sorry? And you say, sorry. Anybody ever said sorry like that? I've heard it a lot, all right? But you know what? You can't do that with Jesus because guess what? He knows your heart. He knows everything you're thinking. He knows if you mean it or not. But if you do, boom, your sins are forgiven, and he won't remember it anymore. Pretty cool, huh? And then the third thing, because that tomb is empty, you know what else it means? It means that we have a new life. Like, we have this life in Jesus. And some of these concepts are kind of hard for you guys, but it used to be, like, in the old way, you had to do something to be something. You know what? With Jesus under grace, do you know that every one of you are something? Do you know how special you guys are to Jesus? You don't have to do one thing to earn his love. Nothing. He loves you just the way you are. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Okay? So tell me. Can you tell me three things? Why is the empty tomb so important? What's the first one? Is he alive? Say it. Jesus is alive. Sweet. Second reason? He forgives our sins, right? And third, we are super special. We are something to be something. And that's pretty cool. And you know what? This is probably maybe above your heads, but it caught me so good when I read this week. A lot of people, like, you guys are so lucky because you already know about the empty tomb. You've already met the empty tomb, haven't you? You know that Jesus is alive. But do you know before you see the empty tomb, you're like, think about those Marys. How do you think they felt when they were walking to the tomb to bury Jesus? Do you think they were happy? Excited? Or were they sad? No hope? Lost? All right? And then when they saw that empty tomb, what do you think happened? Do you think they were more excited than you could ever imagine? Their whole life changed. They ran to tell people. They were fired up. And that's how we should be. And that's why we should tell people about Jesus. Because before you know about the tomb, your life is kind of sad and hopeless. But because you guys know Jesus lives, life is awesome. We have hope and love. Can we remember that? All right. And you know what it really looks like now? What an empty tomb should look like? Watch this. Is like a big party because the tomb is empty? Nice. All right, so let's pray, all right? Dear Jesus, we just thank you so much for each one of these kids on this Easter morning. We just pray that in their hearts they can celebrate that empty tomb. Lord, our lives should never, ever be the same again when we meet you there. We just pray that you be with them and watch over them and keep them safe, Lord. We just pray all this in your name. Amen. All right, so each one of you grab an egg. Empty it out with what's in there, and then remember that empty tomb, okay?
They all walked away, nothing to say. They just lost their dearest friend. And all that he said, and now he was dead. So this was the way it would end. The dreams they had dreamed were not what they seemed. Now that he was dead and gone, the garden, the jail, the hammer, the nail, how could a night be so long? Then came the morning, night turned with the dawn. Death had lost and life had won, for morning had come. The angel, the star, the kings from afar, the wedding, the water, the wine. And now it was done, they'd taken her son, wasted before his time. She knew it was true, she'd watched him die too. She heard them call him just a man. But deep in her heart, she knew from the start, somehow her son would live again. Then came the morning, night turned into day, the stone was
You guys are getting a lot of amens out of me today. What a great day of celebration as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus and what he means to us and what the resurrection means. And so today we're going to continue to worship the Lord and grow in his word and celebrate and give praise to God for what he did. As I invite you to please turn with me to Matthew 28, verses 1 through 10, which can be found on page 1549 in your pew Bibles. As we're going to look at Jesus doing the unthinkable. Matthew 28, verses 1 through 10. With that, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for the unthinkable thing that Christ did in being raised from the grave. God, we thank you for the joy it is that just is in our lives now, knowing that you have given us life eternal, that we eternally belong to you through faith in Jesus Christ and the spirit of your forgiveness, that our sins are not counted against us for what Christ has done, because Christ took our sins on the cross and paid for our sins. And as we celebrate today, it did not end in death, but Christ was risen from the grave. And so, God, I thank you that we serve and worship a living, a risen Lord, that Christ is alive and is at the right hand of you, Lord, interceding on our behalf. And so, Lord, open our hearts and our minds to what your word has to say to us, to your truth. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Hear the word of the Lord beginning in verse 1. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid. For I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you. So the woman hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. Greetings, he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me. This is God's holy and inspired word. Today is a great day of celebration as we remember and celebrate that Jesus Christ is risen from the grave. And as we celebrate today, we kicked off last week of Holy Week with a great Palm Sunday service where the kids were waving their palms and the choir did an excellent job in singing the cantata and sharing about the good news of what Christ did for us. And if you remember last week, after we had such a great service, I went home and there happened to be, bear with me here, a golf tournament on. The Masters happened to be on, and there was this guy by the name, after having a great worship service that came home, this guy by the name of Tiger Woods was happening to win the tournament. Now, he hasn't won a big golf tournament in 11 years, so I imagine none of these kids or my own kids would really even know who this guy was. But for me, in my era, Tiger Woods was this great golfer, and he is, not for just my era, but considered to be one of the best golfers in the world. Tiger Woods was so good at golf that they had to change golf courses to make it harder, just to make it fairer, so that the other guys would actually have a chance to compete against him. And everyone was talking about how he changed the game of golf. And he had all these followers, all these people started liking golf. They started wearing his sponsored clothes and all this stuff. He had a nice brand and all this stuff. Tiger Woods had this great following because he was this great golfer. And then what happened? His back began to hurt, and he started losing. And he started struggling for years and years and years, and he even wondered if he would ever get back. And all those followers who used to follow him started following other golfers and all this stuff, and all the stuff just went away. And so last week, it was pretty crazy to think about that this golfer who hasn't won in 11 years all of a sudden has this chance to win the Masters golf outing. And then it happened. The unthinkable happened. He won the tournament. Tiger Woods won this golf tournament, and you could see all the amazement of what happened. And the unthinkable happened when he won this tournament, and people couldn't believe it. And you could see all the excitement and shouting and joy that happened as everyone was rooting him on as Tiger Woods won this golf tournament. And as unthinkable as him winning this tournament was, Jesus did something even greater than winning the golf tournament. Jesus did the unthinkable. He was raised from the grave. And imagine the excitement that we still feel even thousands of years later. It wasn't just for one weekend, but for all of eternity, we celebrate Jesus doing the unthinkable. He won victory over sin and death. No one has done it before. And so as great as people were celebrating Tiger Woods, we have greater celebration for what Christ has done. You see, Jesus Christ came into the world and he proclaimed himself to be the Son of God. And he was doing great things. He was healing people. He was multiplying the loaves of bread. He walked on water. And Jesus had this great following. Everyone was following. But then what happened? They put him to the cross. The Roman authorities, the Jewish leaders, the people who felt threatened by him, they said, we can't have this happening. And they seemingly got the best of him, nailing Jesus to the cross. And just like the golfer that I just mentioned, soon all of his followers started leaving too. The party's over. It was fun while it lasted, but I don't want to end up the same way that Jesus did. And so what did Jesus' disciples do? They went on, they left, because they didn't understand what Jesus was about. And so it's easy to follow Jesus when things are going great, when we see the miracles and the signs and wonders, right? We like those things. We like it when God does great things, but when things get tough, it's hard to stick around. It's hard to have faith. It's hard to put your trust in Jesus. And so all of his followers, and all of us can relate as well, the tendency is we don't want to be by this. It's too painful to watch. But Jesus showed us, didn't he? Not only did Jesus show us, but Jesus showed the world. Jesus showed the world who he was and what he was capable of doing. And whereas the golfer that I mentioned had his doubts and didn't think he would ever get to be there, Jesus knew all along where he was going. Jesus knew all along what God had called him to do because he is the Son of God. And Jesus knew the way that God had sent him into the world, that his purpose that God sent him was to die on the cross for the sins of the world, that he would be raised on the third day. And he told his disciples, and they still didn't understand. They didn't believe it, right? But when he was raised from the grave, it proved that everything he said was true, that Jesus did what he came out to do and proved it. And so when we look at the resurrection of Jesus Christ, now we see the world following Christ again. Why? Because Jesus won. You know, we are a culture, we are a world, we like winners, right? We follow winners. Jesus paid the ultimate victory. Jesus won the ultimate victory when he conquered death on the cross. And so why wouldn't we be branded in not in worldly things, but branded in Jesus Christ, right? And that is what baptism is. That is our sign that we belong to Christ. That is the brand name of Christ, that we are Christians and belong to Christ who won over death. And so we celebrate the resurrection because Jesus Christ did the unthinkable. And so my question for us today, and the kids had an element of it too, so we're going to reinforce it even more. Because ultimately, when God does something really big in your life, what do? You ask, what does it mean? What does this event mean from 2,000 years ago in my life today? And so there are three things that this proves for us that I want to highlight today. And brought back the fill-in-the-blanks for you all. So if you like that, we got the fill-in-the-blanks. Otherwise, you can follow along. But the first thing the resurrection proves for us is that Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the Son of God. What does that mean? What does it mean? Jesus is God with us, God incarnate, God in the flesh. Jesus is both man and fully man and fully God. And it is a mystery beyond all explanation. And sometimes we would like to think, well, I don't know if that's possible. How can we think? Does it matter? But that is what Jesus proclaimed himself to be. Three times in the scripture, although there's more times, I'm only going to give you three because three is easy to remember, right? So when we look at the Gospels, when Jesus was born or when Jesus was conceived by Mary, what did the angel say? That the Holy Spirit will empower you, be upon you, and you will have a child, and he will be called the Son of the Most High, the Son of God. And so in Jesus' birth, he was proclaimed to Mary as the Son of God. When Jesus was doing his ministry, Nathanael, one of the disciples, says, behold, you are the Son of God. And Jesus himself said that in John 10 when they were the leaders were complaining and saying, you are blaspheming, saying you are the Son of God. And Jesus is saying, I am the Son of God. And ultimately, when Jesus was on trial, even though they couldn't get Pontius Pilate, a Roman authority, to care enough about their religious indifference, after Pilate sentenced Jesus to death, the truth came out, and the leader said, we're putting him on the cross. Why? Because he proclaims himself to be the Son of God. Even today, people are scandalized the fact that Jesus is God, that we worship Jesus, that he's not just a prophet or a normal human being, but we worship him as God. And the question is, how do we know for sure? How do we believe it? How can we proclaim it with such boldness? It's because of the resurrection. Because Jesus used the resurrection as the sign that, as I mentioned in the early service, as the temple of God, that Jesus is the Son of God, because anyone can die on a cross. It's a tough thing to do, but many have died crucifixions. Many people have died for the sake of other people's sins. I mean, wars are fought over conflict, right? But only the Son of God can be raised from the grave, right? And so when Jesus was raised from the grave, it proved that he was who the Scripture says he was. And so if we can get our scripture text from us, I have a scripture to look at, John 20, 31. It says this, "But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." That is the central message of the gospel, not only that of what Christ did for us, but Jesus is the Son of God, that Jesus proved it when he was raised from the grave, and that is why the scriptures write what they do about who Christ is, because he proved himself to be the Son of God. And so if you are like the religious leaders that were attacking Jesus or had their questions about it, or the people that turned away when he started preaching, Jesus continually professed himself to be the Son of God. And he proved it when he was raised from the grave. The second thing the resurrection proves for us is that Jesus Christ died for your sins. Jesus Christ died for your sins. There it is. Jesus died for your sins. When we look at the Old Testament, we see a whole system of sacrifice of lamb, sheep, and goats. Because like we all know, all of us are sinners. All of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And how do we reconcile our sinful selves with a holy and righteous God? Because we deserve punishment. We deserve the wrath of God. And anyone who's been faced before a court or had to go through trial for whatever circumstances know what the weight of the law feels like when you have the law against you and you're trying to make things right and to try to set yourself free. Well, because of our sin, the weight of God's law is upon us. And the wrath of God is on us. And how do we reconcile ourselves with God? How do we come to peace with God? Well, in the Old Testament, what they would do is they would have a sin offering that would be offered, that a lamb or a goat would be offered for the sins of the people to make atonement with God. And what would happen is that animal would die in place for the person or the people who committed the sin. And they would have this on Yom Kippur, Day of Atonement, this whole day of devoting a perfect lamb, because you couldn't have an imperfect animal. Give your best to God, and that animal would die in your place. What do we see in the Gospels? When John the Baptist sees Jesus, he says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the whole world." That is the proclamation of who Jesus is, the ultimate lamb who died for us, that we can be forgiven by God because he took our punishment on the cross. Of course, before Jesus would die on the cross, the high priest at the time, Caiaphas, not even knowing what he was saying, he said, "You know what? Better for one man to die on the cross than for all of us to die." And what Caiaphas was thinking about is he was worried about Jesus was causing such a stir that he was afraid that the people get agitated, that the Roman Empire would come against them and they would all die for causing a revolution. But what Caiaphas unknowingly was predicting was that Jesus would die not only for the many of Israel, but for all who believe and put their trust in him. And that is the message of Scripture. And so when we look at the cross of Jesus Christ, we know that he died for our sins, because if he would just died and been in the grave, he would have been, like I said, like any of us. But what makes the resurrection so powerful is that the fact that Jesus was raised from the grave means that our sins are truly forgiven, that our sins didn't just put Jesus in the ground and we live with our guilt and it's the death of Jesus that constantly haunts us every day, right? But because Jesus was raised from the grave, we know it is done, it is finished. Christ has risen. Our sins are no longer counted against us. And so we don't feel guilty for the death of the cross of Jesus. There is no more guilt for what our sins have done than nailing to the cross. Why? Because everything is made new. Everything's okay because Christ was risen from the grave. And so our passage from 1 John highlights this message. For Christ is a propitiation for our sins, not only for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The word propitiation is a fun word to say. I won't make you say it now, but it means the anger of God. Jesus Christ took the anger of God for our sins, the wrath of God on the cross, but not only for our sins, but for the sins of the whole world. Christ didn't just come to restore Israel, but Christ came to restore all of humanity who put their faith and trust in him. And so the resurrection of Jesus Christ proves that Christ died for our sins. Because if he was stayed in the ground, it would have just been like any other day. But because Christ was risen from the grave, we know that he truly conquered our sins on the cross. So the first 2 points for the resurrection, it proved he was the Son of God. Second, he proved that he died for your sins. And the third point that the resurrection proves is that in Jesus Christ we have eternal life. In the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we have eternal life. If we could get that on the screen. There we go. Eternal life in Jesus Christ. You see, the beginning of the Bible in the book of Genesis talks about Adam and Eve in the garden, right? And before there was sin, they lived in peace and fellowship with God. It wasn't until sin came that they were kicked out of the garden. And the Bible says the wages of sin is death. And so we think about if Adam and Eve, hypothetically, did not sin, they would have lived with God and dwelled with God forever. And Jesus, in John 3:16, said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." And so the question we always have is there eternal life? How do we know that there is eternal life? Does eternal life exist? Because there's so much death in this world. And in fact, that was the argument that the Pharisees, a political religious group, and the Sadducees, another group, both groups that were arguing against Jesus and put him to the cross, both of these groups were arguing over that same reality. The Pharisees believed there was resurrection after death, and the Sadducees did not. And so while they were working together, they always argued over this point. And on a side note, if you read the book of Acts, the Apostle Paul gets them arguing in trials for that very reason. But even in the New Testament, they were arguing in Jesus' time, is there life after death? And Jesus proclaimed himself, yes, indeed there is, for whoever believes in me shall not perish but have everlasting life. And so when Jesus was raised from the grave, Jesus proved what he just said. When Christ is risen from the grave, Jesus makes the case and proves for us in physical elements and physical evidence that the resurrection does exist because Christ himself was raised from the grave. Jesus isn't simply arguing and making a case, but Christ himself is raised from the grave. And if Christ is risen from the grave, then so too shall we be raised from the grave and have hope of the resurrection. And so when we read in Romans 6:5, this is a promise that we have for ourselves. For if we have been united with Christ in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. And so in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we get the proof from Jesus himself that we have eternal life in Jesus Christ. And so when we put our faith, if we believe in the resurrection that happened over 2,000 years ago, we put our faith in Jesus Christ, and then we know because of the resurrection that Jesus truly is the Son of God, that Jesus truly died for our sins, and that in Jesus we truly have eternal life. And so as we look at today, as we look at a great day of celebration, the thought of the resurrection is a wonderful thought, isn't it? It puts us all in a great mood. But the wonderful thing about the resurrection is that we believe it physically did take place. The physical resurrection of Christ did take place, and our physical resurrection in Jesus Christ will also take place. And because of that, we put our faith and hope and trust in Jesus Christ. And so I want to end with this note. I began with the message that winning a golf tournament is fun. And it would be a miracle. I would love it if, Lord willing, I ever got a hole-in-one. Trust me, I'll let you know. And I don't know if there'd be a witness. There should be a witness, right? Yeah. That would be exciting, wouldn't it? I'd be thrilled if I ever got a hole-in-one. Winning in golf is fun, mainly because it's such a difficult sport, right? When you have success, it's exciting. As exciting as it is to win golf, as exciting it is to have glory and fame and riches, nothing can compare to the glory and riches of knowing Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You don't need all the glory and fame and praise from the world because that comes and goes, right? But the glory and riches of Jesus Christ lasts forever. And we don't even have to earn it, because Christ earned it for us on the cross. All we have to do is celebrate with him the joy it is. And so today, as we celebrate on this Easter, as we have some family members in town, as you might take your nap or maybe eat after, whatever your plans are for today, whatever your plans are for tomorrow, we celebrate in the joy of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, because we have hope and the victory in him. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for sending Jesus Christ into the world, for he truly is the Son of God. I know so many people in this world want to say he's just some prophet or a wise guy or, you know, a rabbi or maybe just some philosopher. But Jesus Christ is the Son of God. You came to earth to die on the cross for our sins. And through your resurrection, we put our faith and trust in you, that in Jesus Christ, we are also victors in Christ. And so, Lord, we thank you that we have eternal life in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. God, I pray now as your church that we may never stop celebrating the glory and riches we have in Christ. I know, Lord, it is so easy to go back to our former selves, our former ways, but you have given us eternal hope in knowing our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, fill us with faith. And for those of us who haven't heard this message before, Lord, I just pray blessing upon them as well. That in a life that is filled with so much struggles and death and sin and so much darkness, that we have joy in the light of Jesus Christ. Because the tomb is empty. There is not death and decay, but the tomb represents hope and life and light. And so, Lord, I thank you for that hope in Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen. As we've heard God's message this morning, now we're going to take this morning offering as we give of our gifts to the Lord in supporting the mission of the church and missionaries around the world. And as we do so, we'll be singing Mighty to Save.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Well, everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations.
Can move the
God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. You're my Savior. You can move the mountains. God, you are mighty to save. You are mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, you rose and conquered the grave. Yes, you conquered the
Let us now go to prayer. Lord, we thank you that you are mighty to save, that you are able to move mountains, Lord, just with faith as small as a mustard seed. God, I thank you for the grace and your kingdom and the light of Christ that shines in us, that we can go forth from here sharing the good news of how you conquered sin and death and that we have eternal hope in Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you that all things are in your hand and in your control, that you are sovereign over all things, and that we can place our trust in you when things go good and when things go bad. And so, God, I thank you for the blessings that you've given us, and I pray for your church. I pray for your church here at American Reformed. I pray for your church in this community, and I pray for your church throughout the world, Lord, as we share the good news of the kingdom of God in Jesus Christ. God, I thank you for our guests who are with us today and pray a blessing upon them and those who are watching at home as well. God, I thank you for our congregation and help us to continue to grow in faith, knowledge, and understanding of your word and your truth of the gospel. God, we continue to pray for the ministries of our church and our leaders. Lord, we continue to lift up our elders and our deacons. Lord, we give them prayer as they lead and guide our congregation. God, we support them, and God, we thank you for their service and what they do in leading and serving our congregation. God, we thank you for the staff and the work that they do throughout the week. And Lord, we just thank you for all the teachers and the ministries that go on, the things that go noticed and unnoticed, both in our church and in our community. God, I thank you for the missionaries that our church is able to support and their work that they're doing throughout the world. Lord, continue to protect them and guide them and be with them, Lord, as they are called by you to share what you have put in their heart, the good news of the gospel, and to ministering to others. Lord, we lift up in prayer the needs of our congregation, and we continue to pray for Corey Wiersema and her family with the passing of her mother, Audra. Lord, we continue to be with them. Lord, we pray for Beatrice Grondyke as she's recovering at South Shore from a broken ankle. Lord, we continue to pray for Luke Kuhl as he's recovering from his surgery at home and pray his appointments go well. Lord, we continue to pray for Ken Van Veldhuizen and Janine Decker as they're continuing their journey dealing with cancer. And we continue to lift up Ken Zylstra as well as he's dealing with ALS. God, I lift up in prayers all the needs of our congregation that we are dealing with as individuals or as families and as a community, Lord. God, we want to pray for our neighbors, Lord, throughout the world. Lord, as you call us to love our neighbor as ourself. And so, Lord, we just pray for the members of our community. We pray for our neighbors who live down the street or amongst us, Lord. Lord, we just pray as we are nearing planting season, we just pray, continue for you to watch over the weather and the farmers as they go out into the fields and just pray for safety for all. Lord, we continue to pray for our businesses and industries in town and the work that they do. And we lift up in prayer our schools as well and our children and our teachers and administrators, Lord. Lord, as they continue to serve our community as well. God, we thank you for the work of the nonprofit ministries that go in helping people in need, Lord, and we continue to lift them up as well. God, in all these things, we do it because not of our overwhelming burden, but because of the joy it is to live each day in the grace of Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, I just pray that you be with us this week, Lord, and every encounter we have, every chore that we are to do, Lord, may be for your glory, because all things are for your glory in all that we do. And so, God, we pray now the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and glory forever. Amen. At this time, before we sing our closing hymn, I have a few announcements. And for those of you who are more familiar with our service, I usually have it at the beginning, so I thought I'd throw you guys off a little bit today. As you see, we have beautiful Easter lilies here today in honor and memory of loved ones, so they are fantastic. If you want, you may pick them up today if you want to take them home today. Otherwise, we would appreciate it if we could keep them for an extra week. Because next week at 6 p.m., we're going to have our annual area-wide quartet sing. And so we keep it, since they're singing quartet sings of the gospel, we like to keep some of our Easter decorations up. And so if you're willing, we can leave the lilies here. But if you want to take your lily home that you have in honor and memory of a loved one, you're welcome to do so after the service. This week, the office will be closed on Monday or tomorrow. But I'll be in the office Friday morning, so if you need a, so the office will be open this week, just not on Monday. Also, we had an event scheduled for Wednesday with a creation science speaker, but due to an unexpected conflict, he won't be able to make it Wednesday. Having said that, here's what is going on. I mentioned the quartet sing next Sunday at 6 p.m. here at American Reformed Church, public invited. And we're also excited that Marta Amaro will be here. She's our... We support her and her husband Jaime from Mexico. They're missionaries in Mexico. She's going to be here on Sunday, and so she'll talk a little bit during the service, but she'll be talking during Sunday school hour to share their ministry. We're actually having a team from church going to Mexico to visit them this summer, so we're excited. So we're glad that we'll see her and hear what they're going on, and we'll have a potluck next week following her speaking. So we got a lot going on next week, too. There's always something going on here, isn't there? So just maybe every week just bring food and a fork, okay? I think that'll be easier to remember. So we got all that. It's all in the bulletin. And also, speaking about work of the gospel and missionary work, Arthea Rock and myself, there will be a banquet for Wycliffe, and so we want to show you a short video with that.
Creation itself could testify of him. So creation could proclaim his grace, his goodness, even his love. But man chose to disobey and go his own way. A way that has only led to misery, despair, and darkness. But God is faithful in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. But millions do not have the scriptures in their own language. Jesus' command is to go and make disciples of all nations, and that is what drives our passion in communicating the gospel in every known language, for everyone to hear God's word, to understand his message, to open their hearts, and be changed forever. There has never been a time like now where God's people and technology can come together and translate God's word into every language. To learn more about being involved, come to a Wycliffe Associates banquet and respond to the call of accelerating the life-transforming work of Bible translation. For more information about a banquet in your area, call 1-800-THE-WORD or visit wycliffeassociates.org.
So the banquet will be May 4th. You can get information in the bulletin, and it's on the screen. Contact me. More good food, and they'll have a great speaker sharing the work that Wycliffe does. And so with that, let us stand now and sing our closing hymn, He Lives. Thank you.
Server is the Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever man may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to
the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.
He lives, he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me.